Megaprojects often make headlines for being extremely over budget and having long construction delays. 9 out of 10 megaprojects have cost overruns ranging from just a few million to billions and billions of dollars, which begs the question, which projects wasted the most, and why did they cost so much more money than they were originally planned to? Stay tuned as we take a closer look at 4 megaprojects that went massively over their original budget. If you enjoy our content, make sure to subscribe to Top Luxury. We'll start with one of the world's most famous buildings, which actually went 14 times over its planned budget. Number 4, the Sydney Opera House in Australia. Located at the banks of the Sydney Harbour, it has come to define the city with its soaring sail-like roofs and its unique design, inspired by various things in nature, such as palm trees and seashells. First conceived in 1956, the building's design was selected from an international design competition. The competition brief did not set a cost limit or design parameters. It only asked for an opera house with 2 performance halls that should become one of the most recognizable and greatest buildings in the world. The Danish architect Jom Utzon won the competition. He presented his design and planned to build the structure in 3 phases, starting from the concrete base, to a curved shell roof, and finally to the interior design. Even though Utzon hadn't finished the structural design yet, the government wanted work to begin before the upcoming elections. So, with incomplete preparations, the construction got underway in 1959, with a 4-year construction timetable and a $7 million budget. Since construction was running ahead of the design, a chain reaction of problems plagued the project, and costs began escalating right from the start. A design change meant that the opera house was going to have 4 theaters instead of 2, and soon it was found that the report about the stability of the site was flawed. The foundations that were nearing completion were found to be inadequate and had to be rebuilt to properly support the roofs. As a consequence, 4 years later, by the time the entire project was due to be completed, only the concrete base was constructed. For phase 2 of the project, Utzon wanted the roof to feature shells covered with ceramic tiles. However, he had not yet worked out the precise shape of the shells, and casting them was proving to be expensive and problematic. 7 years after they started, the costs had already reached $22 million, 3 times the initial budget. Utzon had finally managed to work out the design solution for the shells and the special ceramic tiles. However, concern grew over the cost overruns, and a change in government led to increased scrutiny of the project. Utzon believed that design changes and cost overruns for buildings of this scale were common, but the new government was no longer on board. Davis Hughes, the new Minister of Public Works, withheld funding and asked for proof of work before releasing the payments. Utzon could not even pay his staff and threatened resignation if they didn't release the funding. In the end, Utzon stated to Davis Hughes, "If you don't do it, I resign." To which Hughes replied, "I accept your resignation. Thank you very much. Goodbye." After his resignation from the project, Utzon left Australia and never came back. In the following months, Minister Hughes appointed a panel of Australian architects to complete the opera house. The roof was finished 3 years later based on Utzon's design. At this point, the unique shell structure and the use of more than 1 million specially designed ceramic tiles pushed the budget to $85 million. The interior design of the project required a new set of plans and an additional $17 million, taking the total cost to $102 million, which is over 14 times higher than originally planned. Once it was finished, the Sydney Opera House was an instant success, and the government made back what they had spent on construction in just 2 years. Even though Utzon wasn't recognized at the time, he was awarded the prestigious Pritzker Prize in 2003, and what he created was already being compared to some of the most impressive landmarks in the world. The Opera House, meanwhile, has gone on to become one of the most important buildings in the country. In addition to being an architectural landmark, the Opera House also boosts the economy, especially through tourism, with annual revenues reaching the $1 billion mark. After 5 decades into its opening, the budget overruns are rarely mentioned. Utzon is celebrated not just in Australia, but around the world. While the Opera House is now massively profitable, the same cannot be said about the next project on our list. Number 3, the Montreal Olympic Stadium in Canada. The 1976 Summer Olympics brought Montreal global recognition, a few memorable moments, and massive debts that had to be paid back for more than three decades. Montreal won the bid to host the Olympic Games in 1970. At the time, the city was thriving economically, and hosting the Olympics was seen as another big milestone. The mayor, Jean Drapeau, proudly announced that this was going to be the first Olympics ever to pay for itself. He famously said, "The Olympics can no more run a deficit than a man can have a baby." To say that this statement aged badly would be a colossal understatement. At first, Drapeau floated a highly ambitious estimate of just $120 million to hold the games. 60% of this budget was set aside for a grand Olympic stadium called the Big O, which would be center stage at the games. The stadium was to be designed by French architect Roger Taillibert, who had also rebuilt the famous Parc des Princes in Paris. He wanted the stadium to be gigantic, with a dome and a retractable roof suspended from a 175-meter-tall tower. The plans were grand, however, not doable with the budget stated by the mayor. Moreover, the prices of raw materials tripled after the first oil shock of 1971, but no compromises on the design were made. It was criticized heavily, and the lack of flexibility led to massive hikes in the costs before construction even started. By 1972, Mayor Drapeau had announced a revised $310 million budget for the games, with the new stadium now set to cost $130 million. Problems increased further as they failed to deal with Montreal's strong labor unions. Work was scheduled to begin in 1972, and it was delayed by more than a year due to strikes by construction workers. That's why construction only began 3 years before the opening of the Olympics. Time constraints meant that Drapeau had to employ double construction crews and pay over-the-top wages to 3,000 laborers who were working overtime. By the time the 1976 games came around, the much-promoted retractable roof and one of the stands in the stadium of the Olympic Park remained unfinished. Despite the construction mess, the Olympic Games themselves were a success. However, Canada became the first host nation in history to not win a single gold medal. As the games came to an end, Montreal was faced with an even bigger headache. In the final analysis, the Montreal Olympics had cost the city in excess of $1.6 billion, more than 13 times the original estimates. The Big O, meanwhile, had already burdened the city with a billion-dollar bill, without the completion of the retractable roof. The Big O had become the Big O, a nickname that the stadium carried for years to come. An inquiry into what went wrong found Mayor Drapeau had made some serious and costly mistakes. Also, several top officials were convicted of fraud and corruption. This was of little consolation to Montreal residents, who had to pay the stadium's debt for 30 years until 2006. While the Montreal Olympics went over budget by more than $1 billion, we'll now move to an even bigger megaproject. Number 2. The Three Gorges Dam in China. China's Yangtze River is the longest river in Asia and has a long legacy of catastrophic floods. Controlling the deadly waters has been a problem for centuries, and towards the end of the 20th century, an ambitious plan was made. China wanted to build a massive dam that would shield the population from fatal floods, while also catering to power needs of millions of residents. In total, the dam was projected to cost around $9 billion. Construction broke ground in 1994, with high ambitions and big concerns. Altering the flow of the Yangtze would have a huge environmental impact, and more than a million residents would need to be displaced from their homes. Some representatives in the Congress also expressed concerns about whether the dam could really withstand the water masses and stop flooding. Despite the criticism, construction was started and completed 3 years ahead of schedule. The massive dam stands at a height of 185 meters, and its reservoir extends around 600 kilometers upstream along the river. There is enough steel in its structure to build 63 Eiffel Towers, while it is also the heaviest concrete structure on the planet. Today, the Three Gorges Dam is the largest hydropower dam in the world, with its 34 power plants. It has a total capacity of 22,500 megawatts, and in 2020, it generated as much energy as the Netherlands consumed. By producing clean hydroelectricity, the country is also reducing its dependence on coal-fired power plants and saving the atmosphere from 100 million tons of additional carbon dioxide annually. As far as construction goes, the megaproject has fulfilled its promises. However, the costs to build it have risen considerably over the years. According to official estimates, the total cost of building the dam crossed $37 billion, making it four times higher than expected. While some of the costs can be attributed to inflation, more than $10 billion went to relocating around 1.3 million residents. Additionally, they had to deal with landslides, water pollution, and other environmental damages. However, the biggest concerns about the Three Gorges Dam aren't related to cost overruns, but the future of the dam itself. Worries about the structural integrity of the Three Gorges Dam are as old as the dam itself. Increased earthquakes have raised the fear of one massive hit that could cause structural damage to the dam. In addition, there are concerns about the capacity of the reservoir. In 2020, during a period of torrential rains, the dam had to open its gates multiple times to release water from its reservoir. Some of the downstream areas saw record levels of flooding as a result. While China has spent roughly $28 billion more than originally intended on the Three Gorges Dam, it is still quite some ways behind the final megaproject on our list. Number 1. UK's High Speed 2 Railway. Britain's existing railway infrastructure goes back to the mid-19th century, and it is currently the busiest railway system in Europe. The overcrowding and unreliable train services have become a common feature of the West Coast Main Line, and calls to replace it with a modern rail system grew louder and louder. In 2009, the Labour government decided to listen to the popular sentiment and developed a plan to build a high-speed rail connecting the country from the north to the south. The High Speed 2 was planned to connect 8 of the UK's largest cities in a Y-shaped rail network. According to the original plans, the HS2 would connect London to Birmingham and then branch out into legs going up to Manchester in the west and Leeds in the east. The plans also included a 20-kilometer-long Goulburn link that branched off from Manchester to join the West Coast Main Line, connecting Manchester to Edinburgh and Glasgow in Scotland. HS2 was designed to accommodate 18 trains per hour, more than any high-speed rail in the world. These trains will operate at high speeds of up to 360 kilometers per hour, making them some of the fastest trains in the world. Construction on the 530 kilometer long track was planned to be completed in 3 phases over the next 2 decades. The budget for the biggest rail project in Europe was set at $37 billion. However, it quickly became clear that the budget estimates were overambitious, and by the time the government finalized the revealed routes in 2013, an internal review revised the budget to $67 billion. Underreporting the true costs of such massive megaprojects is a common practice. It's done to make the project more attractive to the public and make the approval process easier. The reality is that HS2 will pass through a complex landscape and use some of the most advanced engineering techniques in the world. Construction along the 530 kilometer route involves building more than 50 kilometers of tunnels and 20 kilometers of viaducts. The High Speed 2 will pass through some of the most expensive areas in Britain as well, and a revised evaluation found that land acquisitions cost $2.4 billion more than estimated. The planners also failed to assess the ground conditions at the proposed route. Instead, estimates were made from desktop drawings and real ground data was unavailable to the planners. This caused delays, and by 2015, inflation adjustments caused the overall budget to rise to $85 billion. However, there were concerns that the actual budget might be much higher. After sustained criticism and calls to dump the project, Boris Johnson's government proposed another review of the project in 2019. The official review found that abandoning the project did not make sense, as more than $12 billion had already been spent on it. The High Speed 2 would also have long-term benefits that will eventually outgrow the costs. The review estimated the cost of the project at around $135 billion. That's why a large-scale trimming down of the project was recommended, including measures like reducing the number of trains and major changes to the second and third phases of the project. The construction of Phase 1 was given the green light in 2020 and remains on track for completion between 2029 and 2033, at least 5 years behind the original schedule. Meanwhile, a revised plan published in November 2021 curtailed most parts of the remaining phases, including getting rid of the eastern part altogether. It is too early to say whether the project will be a success or not. However, it is already one of the costliest megaprojects of the 21st century. What do you think? Which of these megaprojects are worth their enormous costs, and which are not? Do you know of any other megaprojects that went massively over budget? Let us know in the comments below. If you want to support our content, leave a like and subscribe to Top Luxury. For more about similar projects, check out our video about the most expensive construction mistakes. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.